Welcome to the Crate and Kobold, a 5th edition D&D podcast. I am your GM Universal, and our party tonight is played by Blaze Masterson.
Hey yo, I am the lord of all things from Silver Run. This shit ain't a game. Oh wait, yes, it is silly fun. If you're looking for rogues, it's true. Yes, I am really one. A half elf, not a horse, though. I am still Philly, son.
What? Okay, let's try and keep on track.
Word.
Bloody Teddy.
Hello, I play Yggdras.
Lots.
Hello, I play Cubby, the resident animal secretary.
This isn't getting any more sensible. Scoo.
Hello, I play Stacey Jatham, the human monk.
And Veer Seraph.
Hi, I play Finna, who's an elf and a wizard.
Excellent.
More wizardly than the Weasleys.
Oh, God.
Okay, so we rejoin our chums as they have just been visited by an enthusiastic young man called Finch. Finch wants to be taken under the wing of Yggdras to receive her wisdom on living a life devoted to the service of Tyr, god of justice. He says, so I'll help out and I'll not get in your way and I swear I'll follow your instructions to the letter. So yeah, this is all good. Will you take me on?
Yggdras sort of looks surprised and thinks for a bit and then smiles deviously and says, yes, I will teach you my ways.
Excellent. Oh, that's a smile I can trust.
Lesson one, lay on hands Valakir, who is like sick. I mean, it hurt.
Oh, yeah, I can't do it anymore.
Can I know, that's why. Yeah, Finch, get over here.
Can I see some of your holy magic?
Yes, yes!
I set my book on fire.
It's one of those, like, I know I got it wrong, but did you spot it?
I was talking about this poor injured woman here. Do you want to show me how you heal?
Well, I've spent all my healing points. I can't do any anymore. Sorry.
Oh, that's a shame. Well, I mean, I'm still quite. It's early days for me. Yeah, I don't.
What level are you? Powers.
I suppose I would be level zero.
Oh, what?
I sadly don't have my paladin powers yet. I'm still in training.
Well then, I guess no healing.
Oh, that's
does no one else have any healing?
I shuffle my feet and just sort of look at the floor.
I can heal.
I just continue holding a cold compress to her head because that's pretty much all I got.
We have healing potions.
Would you like me to heal the young lady?
Could you? Please?
Sure.
He's like dead serious about this shit because Valley is like the one person from his past life that he still has access to. I mean, give it all your juice. I don't think we're about to... Like, we just came back from the confrontation of the Durins. Right? Like, we're still... I mean, if we're still at like, this is the beginning of the evening. Is that correct, Universal?
Yes. It's actually fairly early. Just after lunchtime, I'd say.
Oh, okay. Well, we just went and blew up a boat in broad-ass daylight, which is dope. We got a lot of cojones just doing that first thing in the morning. Like, grab very your coffee so. And then blow up a boat. Like, that's our day.
That's easy to do at night, but, you know, doing it during the day is...
So I'll give her style points. Just a little heel to be getting on with.
All right.
Just so that she goes conscious.
Deal.
Have eight hit points on that young lady.
Excellent. Right. You can see that really helped her out. And some of the sort of her bleeding stops and she sort of comes much more relaxed. Seems like she'll be okay. So, just as you're doing that, there's another knock on the door.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Is this one fucking Simon?
Well,
I open the door since I'm already.
I open the door with Mage Hand. Nobody has to move. I'm too lazy.
It is another young man that you do not recognize.
Sorry, we've already taken in one paladin.
Full house.
oh dear. He's dressed in very sort of poor attire, and he introduces himself. He says, "Hi, I'm Char. I know this might be a long shot, but I was wondering, do you ever work for, well, maybe free is the wrong word, but free?"
Pro bono.
Pro bono. Very good.
As a law type, of course, I know this.
No.
No.
We haven't before, but we also, I do want to remind the group that we do have a literal wagon full of platinum.
Oh, money-wise, yeah, that is
true. Money-wise, we're kind of Gucci right now.
Can we just buy a new base, since this one, a more secure one?
Can we just renovate?
And not, can we replace the door? Will that make, like,
throughout the vampires? Today's adventure session, get us the builders, give us a menu.
I mean, yeah, you're going to need to get estimates, of course, but, you know. So he says, it's just, we have a bit of a situation here, and I don't know if we want the guards for it or not. And, well, we thought of you. It's just we have so little to offer in terms of payment, and, well, I can't really say much more.
Hey, youngin, not that every kid in this town knows each other. Mm-hmm. How about you don't pay us anything, but you help me find a little tyke named Kadu?
Kadu. Well, certainly. What? I mean, Okay, it's not a name I know, but okay. I could maybe. You say he's a young kid.
Mm-hmm.
He's in possession of a lot of money. Like, a lot.
You're big on, like, revealing details. You're big on saying things when it's not.
He's a thief.
Definitely don't know anyone like that. But, okay. So, I'm going to leave this with you. And if you want to take advantage of it, well, if you want to help us out, I should really say, come to Mr. Crimplesham's home for wayward youths and ask to speak to the owner directly, and he will explain.
Now, is the owner Mr.
Crimplesham?
Can't
you just explain, like, right here?
Excellent.
Like, it will save us some time just walking all the way over there. Can you just explain to me?
And he goes to leave, and then he pops his head back in, and he says, one more thing. I was here earlier, and you were out. And there were some of those dwarves looking for you. They went to investigate some commotion going on down by the docks, and they asked me to tell you that there was some woman who wanted to speak to you, and you'd know who she was. Her name was, it started with a V.
Hello? Hello? Hello.
You did your best.
I missed.
Do you know who I'm talking about?
Not really sure. Especially if you see those dwarves again. Not really sure. Take care. Take care, bud.
Thank you. Sorry, Yigbeth, were you saying something I didn't catch?
What did he say? I disconnected for a few moments.
The Durins came by earlier looking for us, and they said that a lady, a V something, wanted to talk to us.
The Durins? Who's the Durins?
Whoa, yeah. Bud.
I literally forgot.
Okay, so the Orkin are the guys who run this city.
Yeah.
A little while back, a bunch of dwarves.
Right. Okay, yeah. Just forgot the name.
Okay. Woo!
Okay.
All right, just making sure you weren't missing like a quarter of the plot.
So, thanks to the healing, it only takes a couple of minutes, really, for Valentine to come around and start to become coherent. Some of the swelling on her face has gone down, and you can clearly make out impact points where an armored fist struck her.
My God.
When she speaks, her voice is sort of robotic, and it seems like she's still trying to get her mind in order.
And robotic?
You know what I mean. Not actually, she's not talking like a robot, but
hello,
she's very, very emotionless. Yes. And she says,
"Beep, boop, in this.
Input required."
What?
So she says, she says to Keys that she dreamed of an old song. She says, it was about a king who lost his family in war. Everything he did to try and end the conflict and bring peace just made things worse, and it drove him mad. Even those he strove for ended up hating him. Finally, he threw himself from his tower, and his death ended up saving his people. And she's just sort of trying, you know, she's getting herself back together somewhat. She'll even sit up, and she looks a bit more together now.
I dismiss these ravings of the fever of her fever dreams. Even though I'm sure it actually matters, and in fact, I wrote it down as a player character or out of character. I'm going to dismiss that and just try and attend to her in whatever way that I can. Kind of, you know, lay gauze on her wounds. And again, this is Keys actually bothering to do something himself, like as opposed to having Belvedere, his unseen servant, do it. Everyone, so that's how you know it's real.
Everyone is shocked. is there anything you want to ask her or talk to her about?
I ask, are you up to talk about what happened here? And I kind of point to my face where the armor marks.
She knows.
The armored glove must have hit her. Are you okay with...
Yes.
Talking about that? Okay. Try and tell me what happened. Try to remember every detail. Spare us nothing if you can. And if you need to stop, feel free to.
Yeah. She sighs and says, well, a raven arrived this morning. Amongst other things, it had a private communication for Rangrim, the captain of our guard. I brought it to his room. He invited me in. Nothing unusual about that. We would often discuss whatever news there was. He opened the communication, read it, and then he went and locked the door. By all the gods, I didn't even suspect then. Rangrim was my friend. For over a decade, we'd been friends. How could I have been? And then she sighs and gathers herself again. He gave me the note to read. I've never had much personal contact with Drumpf Durin. But I know that handwriting, those spelling errors. And it said, and I'm going to post this up at the same time, but this is essentially her retelling of it. The note said, the slag is a traitor. You know that in Dwarven language, slag is like the worst thing someone could call you.
It's a pretty, yeah, I mean, it's a bad one outside of it.
Maybe. It's bad in English, but it's like...
Extra bad just in Dwarven.
The context of
they,
it is,
they can't,
yeah.
They can't call you something worse. No. And even being called that, obviously because she's been living in Dwarven culture, that significance is not lost on her. So it continues, punish her and get her back here as soon as possible. Then do the same for that half-elf beardless shit.
Fuck. Beardless.
I mean, these are dwarves writing it, right?
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
I mean, no one has a beard in the eyes of a dwarf, but a dwarf. Anyway, I'll make him wish he got treatment as gentle as his parents. We'll save the peaceful crap for the next territory. Get our allies moving and hold on. You'll have reinforcements soon.
Oh.
That is just the note up on the screen, or should be. Valentine sighs again. The rest of our meeting you can guess, I suppose. I only ever spoke of you to Dunbarton. I didn't think Rangrim could have known who you were. I betrayed everything, didn't I?
Nothing to be done, Valentine.
We can betray even more now. Tell us about them, their weaknesses.
Well, I think you need to get out of here as quickly as possible.
Oh.
That's pretty clear, Valentine.
At this point, Finch interjects, and he says to Yigbeth, "So, I know this is a big question to start off with, but why does Tyr allow so much injustice in the world?"
Jesus.
We're getting all the hard ones today, aren't we?
Hand in the game.
Well, hey.
Solve my riddle.
Well, young paladin, the gods, they don't have full control over the world. It is up to us to
not disallow it. You're saying they act through us, and we have to create a better world. Yes?
Yes. By any means possible.
Okay. I get it. So, you are all now basically, what do you want to do?
Could I make an insight check on this brash young upstart to make sure that, I don't know, I don't just luck out and discover that he's the avatar of Tyr testing our paladin?
Secretly a mind flayer or something. Absolutely, yeah.
He's working for the Durrans.
That's a reasonable insight. There's definitely nothing in his manner that would suggest he's anything other than a sort of quite nervous, very enthusiastic young lad.
Okay.
You're not getting any sort of weirdness off him, apart from just, there is always this slight thing with servants, or, you know, young servants of some religion, that they often get very over-enthusiastic.
I write all of this in our notes.
He's like suspiciously earnest, I think, is kind of the only thing. Is that about right?
I mean, I'm not sure. I think only Teddy was there at the time, but when they met him originally, he was trying to rob them, and they essentially killed everyone in his gang.
Yeah,
and
I'm literally the only person left.
Yeah, that's weird.
Yeah. I started in episode 9, so like everything before that, it's pretty much Ted only.
You're the keeper of the flame, Teddy. So, how do you want to go from here?
I think we are all going to have to kind of spend the day moving our like wagon full of platinum over to a different place to live.
Oh. And we don't have the coon that's do it for us.
Maybe we do, like, if that's like the only thing he does for us, maybe he can do that in his own absence.
Yeah, but we can.
All I'm saying is, Finna is very nervous because she doesn't have her Goliath buddy to hide behind anymore.
Finna can like enlarge Stason.
I could, but it's just not the same. He doesn't have an elf to boost.
Now, actually, hang on one second. I do want to point this out. With Peleus here, he can shift, wild shape into a giant elk, which is large already. If you improve that by one, he becomes a colossal elk, and you're still riding on him. Because that elk, that giant elk, can seat 6.
You could make me gargantuan size. That would be awesome.
Yeah.
Perfect for running and hiding.
For other people.
I'm just like holding on to the mane, like cackling wildly. Just like under 5 foot elk.
Do elk?
We're gonna make it happen. Well,
at that size, you would. At that size, you would have a mane. It would be because your hair would be like 6 feet long.
Wouldn't you guys
short in real life?
Wouldn't you guys have like an attachable carriage that just goes on my underbelly while I roam around?
I think we need more time to custom craft that.
Yeah, I was thinking about buying some jewelry for your horns when you shapeshift, and you hate it, obviously, because you're not a fancy boy like I am, but I love it, and I just cast it like a net of gold that I cast onto your horns whenever I ride you, just for effect.
So you do have the carriage that you came in.
But this is cooler.
Absolutely.
Okay. Well, we don't want to draw too much attention to us, considering we don't want the Durns to know where we're going.
Yeah, well, I mean, we don't need necessarily to be colossal elks per se right now. But yeah, we'll have a... Because Takuna naturally has got like a high carrying capacity, and he is only 9 feet tall, that's a weird thing to say. Maybe we'll just have him kind of haul the carriage for us, because he's got like that extra, the Goliath thing means that he can lift like thousands of pounds in sweat.
Yeah, certainly if you want to use him just in a non-player capacity, that is fine.
All right, we're going to, where can we even go to ground right now?
Go to the...
What about the burned out slums district where people aren't really looking?
We might seek a place from the Black Hand. There is a place that belonged to the adventurer party. Heretto.
Yeah,
Heretto and his group with Ginger, the gnome. So
if only we had a mobile base, like a boat or something. Damn it.
Oh man.
To be fair, that would be pretty obvious, but
oh man, now I feel
steal another boat.
We turn up once.
Well, no, nobody else deserves it though, because that was the only Durin boat there.
Wait, the Durins only have one boat? Are there not others?
No, they have tons. They're just the only ones here in this city. So like they don't have reinforcements or anything. Currently here. They're just gonna bring in a shitload of people and we're gonna have to prepare. Oh god.
Yes, certainly from that letter, it sounds like this time it's war.
I have a question. Does that ability to enlarge, can that also make things smaller? And does it work on non-living things?
The enlarge reduce spell does in... it can double the size of something or halve the size of something.
Mm-hmm.
And let me read the description. Creature or object,
when cooking.
Does it last like a reasonably long time?
Up to 1 minute.
Oh. So we couldn't just shrink all the treasure and run off with it.
No.
That's kind of brilliant, but when that pops back up to size.
It pops back up to size and you're using it as like a rickshaw, that's a hernia. That's a real bad hernia at the best.
So
we could just leave all the treasure and steal it later.
Have a Goliath to take
what
it
if
to.
We spend
we
it?
Have a place to go to. We have a Goliath that can carry us.
What if we buy a boat?
Let's just go to a bank.
What is this buying? It's in the vest.
I doubt. Now, Universal, it's up to you. Why don't you tell us about the status of banking in your world?
Well,
I hope you figured this out.
I hope you've got a delicate, complex economy for me to fuck with.
It's incredibly
the interest rate.
What's the banker's name? What's the name of this NPC?
There's so much detail. His name is Kevin. Kevin.
Kevin the banker.
Are you looking around your room for what's the name?
Kevin Orc. Kevin the Orc. The world's
he's an orc
banker.
Or his name is Orc.
Welcome to Creighton Kobold, ghost and does chores and does responsible fiscal planning.
Mm-hmm. Well, if we're getting this deep, you have to tell me all about your laundry cycles and what you're having for breakfast. And,
could actually
what's
spend
a laundry
it?
Cycle?
You could go to like that place.
Casino.
No. I could get some enchantments on my like armor. Mm-hmm. Remember that costing like 1,500 gold.
How much do we have? Enough money to do whatever. We've got 40,000 gold, is my remembering. I think that the last time we established that was like 3 months ago, though. So
didn't we give some? Didn't we give some to the Fames?
Yeah. Yeah, we gave a shitload. We gave like 10 G's to Sarah and Cersei Fames to go to ground.
Yeah. Are there any sort of mercenaries we can hire to help?
Maybe.
Can we hire a couple of clerics?
Honestly, that's just gonna ship.
No, we're just gonna get tutors.
No, I don't want tutors or hirelings. I want to be the hero. Set up an army. Like,
let's build a school. Let's teach some kids. Get them jobs, and then
it'll make
later...
you more popular than you can run for election.
Oh no!
Play
I'm
the
gonna...
long game.
You've got to compete with Mr. Crimplesham's Home for Wayward Youths.
Yeah. You see, we're already on the back foot. Wow, you're right.
It's a harsh market. Yeah.
Wow, now that you've established that, listen, we can't go spending this money willy nilly. I need it for my philanthropic endeavors to prepare the way for usurping the entire leadership of the town.
Yeah, checks out.
Yep.
So. What would you like to do?
We're going to take Webtish Black Eyes. We're going to have him run the cart over to the home of Ginger and Heretto, the former home at which we discovered the knave could do.
Okay. Give me a perception roll.
Oh, I'd love to.
Oh, no. Are you better at percepting now?
Everything's fine.
I'm like amazing at percepting. I just can't roll it ever.
This is wonderful. I can rely on this not happening.
That's a five.
Yeah, I can. I will never get a good roll.
Can I do it? Can everyone do it?
No.
Please, this shit. Next time I'm rolling.
Tell you what, one more person.
Who has the best? Wisdom.
Let me see. I think I'm quite wise.
I have plus one.
What is it? Perception?
Perception.
No. Plus three. But no proficiency.
Okay.
That's good enough. Not like super because you're a druid? Not good at wisdom?
I have proficiency in perception. Okay. And I'm wise-ish.
Do you have a plus three or better?
I don't know.
Better than a plus three.
Jesus!
Okay. Wow. Okay, that is actually very good.
He has a plus 23.
Not that good.
So, you notice a couple of things. One is that as you basically bundle up your stuff everyone's stuff into the cart and get going, you notice that there are a small troop of kind of maybe 20 or so dwarves heading your way further down the street. But it looks like you got out just in time.
Oh.
You also notice just above you, on the rooftops of the city, a figure watching you.
Finally! The elusive bird man.
Does it look like a bat? Like a Batman, okay. Perhaps? Well,
how is it? Isn't it like broad daylight?
Yeah. I mean, you only catch the slightest glimpse of it.
I convey this information to my companions.
Jesus!
Oh, looks like a...
Oh, no!
I know!
I didn't even look at the page. It was just the thumbnail preview in the Windows taskbar.
Owned. We all got owned. Again.
I think that looks like a very beautiful figure.
No!
Wait, so could the Birdman have been this guy the entire time?
No, I don't think so. I think that Simon Amer was not lying to us during that time. He said that this thing was like extra, extra, extra dimensional, and that the thing he seemed to imply to me, at least, my understanding, that the thing that was following us was actually the third member of the Ark in Harlow, Atlanta Harlow.
Oh, was it not just them?
Yeah, I don't think it's unfair to say that, yeah, it was Alant Harlow who attacked Seraphim's.
So it was Harlow who attacks people, and so he's the birdman that people see attacking, but the eyes that have been on us this whole time belong to this extra dimensional figure. Okay, so now we know precisely who the birdman is and exactly in what circumstances the birdman was the birdman and in what circumstances the birdman was the mysterious figure.
So not a birdman.
We're still gonna call him the birdman.
Oh yeah, you have to.
Just call the mysterious figure the birdman.
No. The birdman is Atlanta Harlow in his like bestial form that
Atlant.
Atlant, thank you. I'm sorry.
Atlant.
Atlant. I was looking at it written. Atlanta is like how I was pronouncing it. So like yes, Atlant, thank you. Harlow, Harlow is clearly the birdman that attacks people. Like that was the reason why we came up with birdman, was to name the thing that was attacking people. Mm-hmm. Okay. Important information. Thank you. Thank you lots for doing what I could not.
Finally. How many sessions has it been?
Oh,
how many perception rolls?
It's been six. I really want to say like six, five or six.
Maybe now you'll let me walk barefoot without complaining.
You've definitely proven your worth, my darling. And then I just scratch on your fur.
I see better without my shoes.
Okay.
What? So you are making your way to the sort of hidey house of... I've totally forgotten his name.
Perotto and Ginger and
the previous
the other party. Yeah, there were I think four other members of that party that got ate by the Arkan.
Mm-hmm.
We're in dangerous. This is hard, guys. So yeah, apparently we're gonna abandon the bakery and leave the signage up.
Mm-hmm.
Still gonna read Brian
back Ainge. In 5 minutes.
Yeah, absolutely.
Sorry, we're closed.
Yes, you take one last wistful look back at the bakery, which has been your home.
Under nude management.
That's the name of your...
Bakery.
Bakery.
No one ever comes in. It's weird.
Interesting enough, this place isn't protected from... Land either, because he did come into this house and killed the party members. So at some point they allowed him to come in.
You don't know who it was who attacked the party.
Well, I mean, wasn't it also the Clawmark guy?
Is there a third Birdman?
But there was claw marks, and they were the same claw marks that. When he got into our house, and I remember Sarah said that was the guy who attacked her.
Yeah.
So
no.
So it has to be him.
She wouldn't have known. Okay, you know that the Arkan are all vampires, right?
Right.
Yeah. Okay, that's all. That's all I'm saying.
Oh, okay. So they all have access to kind of the same, roughly the same form. So either Atlanta came in.
Theoretically, yes.
Or perhaps another member of the Arkan, which that throws a wrench in my delicate political plans, because as far as I could tell, the only unreasonable one was Harlow.
Well, but... I mean, that's, again, I'm not confirming or denying in this
case. I guess they didn't actually kill anyone, because that guy killed himself.
One of them killed themselves, yeah.
Yeah, and the other one was kidnapped. The other one...
One was kidnapped. In fact, they all got taken to the tower.
And eaten.
Oh, yeah. Well, I guess to all of them are pretty unreasonable then.
Well, all of them are vampires.
Yeah, I mean, you just kind of have to accept that they're vampires, because the only other alternative is to let the Durrans, like, take over without any organized opposition, right?
We can just kill both of them.
Yes. Yeah, that's a good spirit. I like that spirit. Okay, I like that spirit, and as politically, I agree with that spirit. What I really want to do is go ahead and take that spirit, harness it to destroy the Durrans. Then when our enemy count is a little bit more manageable, this is why politics is the art of compromise. You really have to prioritize things. So then when our enemy count is a little bit more manageable, perhaps we'll figure out what to do with these Arkan fellows. But in the meantime, they've got a large organized guard. They've got presumably an organized military. If the city guard and the military are probably exactly the same and interchangeable, that are loyal to them. Let's use that. This is kind of me in character, right? Saying all this. Let's use all that organized infrastructure against the enemy and not upset this delicate balance right now.
See Finch taking a note that says, kill political rivals.
No, not
yes,
yet.
Yes.
No.
Yes.
I'm learning a lot, but thank you.
Finch is definitely
excellent.
Learning from
the Rob's hands.
So, is there anything you'd like to do now? You've basically set yourselves up in the house, and you feel like you're pretty safe here.
Okay, can I dispatch ravens? Can I text somebody?
You would have to go somewhere where there are ravens.
All right, I think I'm willing to brave the streets. I'm going to use the tunnel that goes underneath this house to pop out of the alleyway opposite it, just to try and sneak off.
We should probably seal that in so that our other 40,000 gold won't get stolen.
No, we should leave it open to Kadu, because I want to find that motherfucker. So, anyway, the point of the story is I want to run off a message to Zygum Bainin, number one. He's the guy who had us go into the tunnels that led us under the Arkan Tower, where we discovered all of the dead bodies that everybody's been using for 350 years, and we wound up killing their half-vampire servants. Yes. I'm going to say to Zygum, no further expeditions under the Arkan Tower necessary. Unwise to proceed. Stop. Do not continue. Do not begin operations there. Stop. Dwarven ruins.
Excellent.
Unsafe.
Cool. Okay.
Wait, one more thing. Need weapons silvered as payment for expedition stuff.
Okay. They were just waiting for us to come out of the caves. Yeah. Are they still standing outside?
No, there was an old woman.
Forever.
Yeah, plug up tunnel under old woman's house. Stop.
I kind of want to meet the roof-dwelling stranger.
We have met him before, but he's so extra dimensional that all he does is kind of stand there and stare at you.
Oh yeah.
And the lore behind him is that even the Arkan, the guys who are in control of the city, who also are immortal vampires, who have been in control of the city for about 350 years following some unspecified cataclysm, they are super powerful magically. They were able to contact this thing. They don't even understand how this thing works. So this mysterious figure is extremely mysterious. I have tried giving it a hug, by which I mean a punch, and it just disappears. You can swing at it or like try and attack it or whatever. It just disappears, reappears right next to you, observing. It is a watcher. It is Uatu.
Do we know why they called it?
To act as their eyes and ears. It does provide them somehow some way of reporting back.
It does seem like a very advantageous spy thing to have.
It's annoying. I want an extra dimensional spy.
Well, if you're very good and Prate is here.
Orcus.
Orcus.
Yes.
So cuss away. Hey, see what I did there. Anyway, so
Second Raven.
Second Raven.
Second Raven goes to the Arkan. Uh-huh. Prepare for war.
Can you just you can just like shout and the mysterious figure will hear it. And report back.
I'm a professional, damn it.
Might as well save the money.
Yeah, let's save money. We've got 40,000 G's. Yeah, let me save like the 2 copper to the bronze. So I'm just gonna say prepare for war. Durin's no.
Okay.
Through no fault of our own. Stop.
Stop.
Yeah. That last part was especially convincing. Time.
Hugs and kisses. Yeah. Stop.
XOXO.
Yeah. Yeah. Absolutely. Okay, so depending on the exact mores, the exact cultural expectations of this time period, I would do the equivalent of signing it like your loyal servant. Like, yo, I got your back, love keys. Like, whatever the equivalent of that is, like, yo, I'm with you. We got to kill these Durins.
Okay.
And like, cool. Keys eventually would love to usurp their power, but like, maybe not. Maybe it's not opportune. And if not, let him live.
Stop.
In the name of love.
Stop.
Don't stop till you get enough.
He's doing this, can I go enchant my robes? Get some money
in. Oh, enchant your robes. Right. What sort of enchantment are you looking for?
Immortality.
Increased AC.
How much gold do you have?
40,000.
Okay. Right. Yep, that will be possible.
For 39,000.
Let me just double check. Do I have any notes on shopping? Because that's what everyone wants to do these days. Where is my shopping? Here we are. So, do you guys have, while I'm looking this up, do you guys have a sort of other things that you want to do? Do you want to go to home for unfortunate youths? Or do you want to do anything else more specific to anything?
Maybe the home for unfortunate youths has some rare and valuable unfortunate youths that could be serviceable for our travels.
No, that's the home for fortunate youths.
Aw. So it's a value judgment as opposed to like a situational assessment.
Well, you see,
these youths
the
are unfortunate in that they're not useful for things.
The big issue here being that they're all the way on the other side of town and we don't have time to go with it. The unfortunate one is a lot nearer.
Yeah,
fortunate one, no.
There's probably a lot more paperwork involved too.
What's the AC of your
16.
Armor? 16. Okay. Let me just double check. What do you think?
How much would a +2?
+2 armor. That is going to be 4,000 gold.
How much are the +1?
I'll give you that for 2,000 gold. That makes sense.
How much would a +1 for my Morningstar?
Let's see.
2,000. Everything's 2,000.
Really? Yeah.
It's like a pound shop, but it's for 2,000.
By the way, that reminds me. Who was it picked up that fancy spear that the dwarf dropped in the last session?
Oh, that was Stason.
Stason. Oh, sure. The spear itself is like a spear of swiftness.
Ooh.
And it essentially gives you a +2 onto hit rolls.
Ooh. Wicked.
With anything made with the spear, not with your hands.
Is it a magical weapon? Does it count as magical?
It's not magical, it's just very, very well made.
So could I use it as a quarterstaff?
Yeah, I don't see why not.
Well, I mean, a spear is one of your monk weapons. Yeah.
Oh, is it?
Yeah, okay. It's you're good. You're Gucci, baby. It's the top tier monk weapon.
What is the damage dice?
1d8
on that.
Poking.
1d8. Okay. Cool.
Piercing or nice. Whatever. It also has the reach, I want to say.
Oh, yeah. It goes two squares, doesn't it?
Yeah, in which case, it's kind of a dope little extra. Although your arms don't, so like that's kind of why it's not like the very best to have that.
It could be situationally useful. Well, certainly. What are we calling this then? The
Spear of Swift.
Well, you can call it whatever you want. Your first task in the military is to name your weapon.
Oh,
I recommend Pokey.
I might call it Taylor.
Stason's Swift Spear of Penetration.
Nope.
Oh, I'm sorry. I take that back. It is versatile and does 1d8 if you're using it two-handed.
Yeah, it's like a quarterstaff, in other words.
Cool.
Yeah.
Which I would be using two-handed.
This also allows you to act with a thrown, so you can throw this. Range is 20-60.
You wanted a upgrade to your flail.
Morningstar.
Morningstar. Yeah, that's actually going to be for a +2 to hit. That's going to be 6,000.
What about +1? It's 3,000.
Yeah.
I don't think we'll mind like 5,000 gold missing, right?
I'm not there for those negotiations. I'm just throwing that out there. Like, I'm not there to approve this budget. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Well, it is out of our pool of money. I am not there to like say like.
I think we're gonna need this. So.
All right.
Need to make plans for the present, not the future, or whatever. The sentence doesn't make any sense. Huh.
Does Finch note that?
I'll buy Finch a little Morningstar as well.
What?
With my own money.
Can't you just give him your old one? Or are you getting yours pimped up?
I think I'm getting my own mine.
All right. Okay.
Yeah, it's enchanted. So. So Finch is like incredibly flattered by this. He can't believe his luck. He says, "I will treasure this."
How much does it cost? I'll take it out of my own money.
16,000 gold.
Excuse me? No, a normal Morningstar.
A normal Morningstar costs 15 gold pieces.
Oh,
okay, thank God, right. Jesus Christ.
he says, this Morningstar, I swear, it will be a legend of justice.
So now my Morningstar is like magic?
Yeah, it's got a magical enchantment that makes it more reliable. You could have an enchantment that does extra damage, but yeah. So, do you guys want to? What do you want to do?
Anybody else need to get some shopping done?
I want to get basically a. Is there like? I should really find out what enchantments are available.
I should have probably done that too.
I'm just BSing
all this right off the top of my head. So.
Let me find my. I basically want to give. I want to get some kind of a hood or something that would give advantage on sneak, or stealth.
Okay.
That would be along the lines of the boots of elvenkind, or the cloak of elvenkind, I should say, which I believe is rare. Sense.
The hood of elvenkind.
Yeah. It's like a more lightweight version.
It's made with fresh elves.
I'm
elvenkind. Come on.
Rethinking my desire to buy it.
I like to buy vegan shoes. I don't want them to be made from elves.
No elves were harmed in the testing of this product.
Wait, are they made from vegans?
You can have light generation on your weapon. You should like 3% of mana.
Quick question for you about the Spear of Swiftness. +2 to attack. How do I get that to work
just
built in?
You can't
change the +2.
You can add a magic bonus.
Yeah, that adds
it to the damage as well. So I'd have to do -2 to the damage. Yeah, that's what it says. Yeah, mouse.
You can do that. You can do a -2 to your damage.
Okay, I'll just do +2 to magic bonus and then a -2 to the damage.
So I get a +1 to attack and a +1 to damage.
You shouldn't, unless the GM told you. But...
Well, I mean, a +1 by nature is +1 to attack and +1 to damage.
Oh, okay. So hold on. Is this but your swiftness what not you got, giving me damage?
No, what you got was to hit.
Okay. So I'm doing -2. I'm just going to do a test roll just to see what we're doing this.
Universal, I am answering some of these questions in your stead. Like, that please correct my ass.
That is completely fine.
You can actually do it in the core stats tab. Below, in bonuses and penalties, you can add +2 to attack rolls.
But in his case, he uses his unarmed strike so much that doing that would be... Yeah, it would wind up applying to his fists a lot.
It's okay. This works, I think, if I'm reading the mouse shit correctly.
Possibly the simplest way to do it would just be to add on the description of the weapon +2 to attack, and then just remember. As long as you see the name, you'll remember.
Well, I mean, go ahead and do a roll so that we can see that the 1d8 minus 1.
I have it. That's there. So it says +9. That's because I have 7 to attack. So it's added in on the 2 to the attack. So I actually rolled a crit 1, but still got a 10. A crit fail, sorry, and still got a 10 because of the +9.
Okay, and then the damage.
And the damage.
You got a critical fail on that.
I rolled a 1.
Yeah, you got a critical fail on that, but it was also a +4, which... Is your dexterity?
It was a +6, -2. Yeah.
Right. Okay. So it does work. We have it functioning. Cool. Excellent.
It just so happens I rolled 2 crit ones. So let's hope we got those out the way.
You got a hot hand tonight, baby.
Ooh, snake eyes. can I call my spear of snake eyes?
You can call it whatever you like.
Just don't call it late for dinner.
Don't call it late for stabbing. let's see. So, if everyone wants to buy themselves a fancy magical doodad, I will give you an amulet of stealth bonus, basically advantage. Did you get it? Mm-hmm. All right, okay. Cool.
So we can all buy a magical item. I have no idea how much of Key's money I can spend.
It's not his money.
It is not mine per se. I just have big plans. I'm the dreamer.
I say, whispering, "Go nuts."
So, ooh.
So right. I'm assuming that the spear.
He said donuts. He said donuts.
Yes,
buy some donuts.
Very expensive, legendary magic donuts.
You buy the world's first Krispy Kreme.
Now that'll make us money. I'm okay with that.
It's a new line for the bakery.
Anything about the stealth amulet? Got it. What?
Sorry?
The stealth amulet. What? How stealth is it?
Okay, so it gives you an advantage on the stealth roll, yeah.
Ooh, I like that.
Pretty good.
I'm like, definitely as soon as I buy it, I just start sneaking around in circles. I'm not even trying to do anything. I'm just trying to walk around and just see how many people stop noticing me and just laughing.
Pure Skyrim shit right there.
Yeah, just straight like, crouch, like, uncrouch.
Now you see me? No, you don't. Gotcha. Oh, I'm crouching.
Oh, this is gotcha. I haven't said it. Yeah, basically. Oh, man. So happy.
Okay. So essentially, you're walking around and you think you're always being seen, but there's a rabbit behind you. That's all it is. So
well, then I just put a bucket over a chicken's head and it's all fine.
Yeah. Okay. So has everyone got what they want?
Wouldn't say no to a folding boat.
No one would.
One of those like backpack canoes, but like size to fit.
Yeah,
it's actually it's a 1 foot by 6 inch by 6 inch box that can unfold into a boat.
How am I gonna price that?
it's a rarity is just rare, so it's apparently not that pricey. Okay. has three command words. Let's see. One, blah, blah, blah.
Oh,
in the middle of crisis.
There is actually a price for it. Are you ready? Yeah. It's 10,000 gold.
Too much. Is uncommon less common than rare?
Yes, probably. Yeah. Okay.
So?
Uncommon is much more common than rare. It goes uncommon, rare, very rare, legendary.
Got it. So I'll stick with the uncommons. But we, if it helps move things along, we can move along, and I'll just
you can later. Retrospectively have shopped at any point if you find something.
Cool, works for me.
Okay, right. So, with your fancy new bling, what are you doing?
I know what I've been doing this whole time. Mm-hmm. Crouch. Given getting a good quad workout.
Doing them lunges, those stealth lunges. That's a nice move. I've never thought of doing stealth lunges before, and now I
highly recommend it.
I know how I'm going to spend the rest of my afternoon, frankly.
I like to think you're in a gymnastics class and just everyone appears and disappears suddenly. So, okay. Yeah. Right.
So we've wrapped up a couple of story threads. We need to, now we probably need to try and find our man Rangarin.
Yes. Well, you have an idea about where Rangarin would be, i.e. the Caversham Manor.
Mm.
I just noticed that those names are very similar.
Turn to Castle Caversham. Or not Castle.
Again. Let's go down that stupid elevator and that stupid dungeon. The stupid.
Well, hang on. We do have. So the orphan who talked to us earlier today from Mr. Crimplesham's home for wayward youths, he handed us a little note and wanted us to check this out pro bono. We're just about to cause a fucking war pro bono. So which do you guys feel like doing? Checking out what's going on with this orphan move or advancing the political war narrative here.
I figure let's check out this detour and if we could somehow cause a war along the way.
War is always on the table.
Yeah.
Yeah. I feel like war. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely.
And you know, maybe
what is it good for? Absolutely side quests.
Mm-hmm.
It's pretty good for shopping motivation as
well. Also that, yeah.
Good for the economy.
Okay, so what are you doing with Valentine? Are you going to leave her here? Are you going to bring her with, or what?
Oh, God. I'm just going to have to leave her here.
Yeah, she's basically able to take care of herself now that she's been healed up and, you know.
You know,
and she says she'll... Up to you. She will defer to your judgment. She's kind of not in the best of places at the minute, but...
Yeah, I mean, like, no offense, but putting the clothes sign up probably won't work that well for very long.
Well, no, I mean, the thing is that we are now in a place that the Durins don't know about. The Arkin almost assuredly know about it by dint of the mysterious figure, but right now the Durins have no idea where we might be, and in fact, like, should be nobody else in the city. Should be a matter of, like, the Arkin have this little pocket of knowledge, but... the Durins.
True.
They like this is just another abandoned building. We got in through the tunnel.
Yeah, we can just tell her to about the tunnel. That'll probably be a good escape if they come here.
Okay.
Yeah, I will leave her with all my very best rations and have Belvedere cook her dinner before I go.
I'll tell the I don't know, should I bring the paladin dude along?
Oh, he's coming.
Yeah, that's just, that's nature.
Fine.
He's a duckling who's imprinted on you.
He says, so you'll work for free when the situation seems just.
Well, we don't know what the situation is yet, so I guess we'll see.
Ah, of course, very wise, very wise. Okay, yeah, I get it.
I leave Valentine a stack of reading materials, but they'll probably bore her to sleep, which might be handy.
Yeah, thank you.
You know, like, you yeah. know.
Thank you for that.
She says, thank you for your kindness.
I'm not sure.
I leave her a religious book as well.
She says, thank you for your kindness.
Is this the book you used to beat that bandit to death?
No, that's a different book. I'm keeping, okay, good. I'm keeping the beating book with me.
I say aside to her, like, don't read that part. No,
that's an office to stay behind her.
You see the first smile sort of crack across her face, and she nods. So, right, so you're heading for Mr. Crimplesham's home for wayward youths. It is kind of a famous enough building. It was actually one of the first mansions that was built by, you know, the rebuilt city. But it became run down because it's positioned inside the poor quarter. In fact, the funicular track passes just by it, and the building actually shows some freshly repaired signs of damage to one of its wings. You know, damage from the air, shall we say. Terrible how that goes, but you go in through the building and people will tell you, you know, Mr. Crimplesham, he's in his office. So if you wanted to go in and see him. He is currently in some sort of a meeting, but it's not long before the door opens and he leads one of his you know, child charges out. He sees the party and he says, could you go and fetch Marcus and send him here for me? Thanks. You'll usually find him in the library.
Is this our pro bono quest? Fetch Marcus?
Yes, it is. No. He says to the kid to go and get Marcus. And Mr. Crimplesham is sort of waving you to come in and sit down, please, make yourself at home. He's a very
fetch quest.
Yes, he will get 10 XP for that. he's a quite severe looking old man in his 60s. He's dressed very plainly and he's real thin. But by all the rumors that you would have heard of him, you know, he works very hard and educates and houses homeless kids. So he says, well, it's very good of you to come and consult with us on this. So the situation is, there's a building nearby that is technically part of this estate that we don't use. Well, we don't have the money to use it. We rely on donations here, so the building has been empty for years. Well, I say empty. Right, I knew for a long time that people had been squatting over there, and to be honest, that never really bothered me. I met them occasionally, got to know some of them. Occasionally I'd bring over, you know, spare food that we had, and, you know, just generally speaking, they were folks down on their luck, looking for a safe place to sleep. Most of them even pitched in and helped with the upkeep of the place, which we just didn't have the time to do. Anyway, this morning I brought over some blankets I thought they could use. We recently received quite a generous donation from the Jurans, and we found that the entrances were blocked, or I found that the entrances were blocked, and I could get no response from inside. Then, of course, that explosion happened over by the city hall, and some of us went over to see if we could help. When we got back, it turns out that one of our students, that's Marcus, was waiting to tell me about what was inside. Let's see. Hold on a second. He's getting a wand. All right, okay. we'll get to the magic missile wand in a few seconds. Let's see, where did I stop? Yeah, so, Marcus was waiting, basically, and just told me about what he saw inside. Now, he's a good kid. His head's always in a book. I swear he could take over the running of this place tomorrow if he wanted, but he does like to explore. Anyway, so he explains how he found his way in, and he led my assistant Char over there. And he says that the place has just been almost hollowed out. It's like the ground just gave way and sucked in the entire building apart from the outside, and there's no sign of anyone inside. There's a knock at the door, and he raises his voice and says, "If you're Marcus, come in. If not, bug off for a couple of minutes." And the door opens, and Marcus walks in. Grimblechum continues, "We haven't really checked very thoroughly, and we'd rather it was you who saw the city guard, if you understand. Chances are we'll lose the property if they get involved. And that's fine. That's totally fine if that's the way it has to be. But I'd like your assessment of the risk, if you'd be willing."
"You can rely on our discretion."
"That's excellent." It's as he's saying that, that you and Marcus meet each other's gaze.
Okay.
And painful memory in Keyes's mind.
"Hey, young pup."
Marcus says, "Oh, hello, sir, and guests." And Cripplesham just raises an eyebrow and says, "Hello? Yes, yes, sir, it's the new thing kids are saying." Cripplesham just shakes his head fondly and says, "I want you to take these folks and show them how you got into the building, okay?" "Okay, sir, are you coming?" And says, no, just bring them to the building and bring them to the building and, yeah, saunter on back."
Ready to cast a spell. If he tries to run off.
Marcus says, "Oh, okay. Very well. That's no problem. Certainly. Sure. Cool. Do you want to come with me?"
"Let's us do."
"Okay. One more thing that Grimstrom tells you before you leave, that there were 7 people living inside." He says, I don't know if this is relevant. "There were 2 people who joined the group recently. And according to the folks who I knew there, they were all saying that they seemed kind of shifty, that maybe they were on the run from something. But I have no idea if this has anything to do with that. I just thought
shit. This is the Birdman attacking again, isn't it? They were the fucking front of the party. I can see it all happening."
Back in the hallway, Marcus says to you. He closes the door, and he says, "Okay, so are we going to have a problem?"
"Oh, that depends on you." "Yeah, I'm just gonna be the bigger man because I'm literally the bigger man." And I kind of kneel down and say, "Well, that depends on you."
"Yeah, where's the money, punk?"
Finch is just like taking notes. He says, "Well, it's kind of out of my reach."
"Go on.
It's all
spent. I'm the good cop here, remember.
It's all spent. All gone."
"Go on."
"Can any of us fly? Pick him up."
Crossing time. From above, there is the sight of a bird man.
Can't fly, but I can swim indefinitely.
"Do not waterboard a child."
I was suggesting drowning him a little bit, not waterboarding.
that's kind of the same thing. Yeah.
No, that's just an alternate fact.
No.
That's,
we're gonna get flagged on YouTube now.
Not part of this game.
So he says, "No, money. There's no more money."
Where'd you spend it?
Well, I feel like that would be a bad idea to tell you. And
it would be a bad idea not to tell me.
Wow.
How about I take you to see this building and we just say goodbye, say our goodbyes, and
how about no?
I'll run on.
Oh no, I'm gonna pick him up by his suspenders.
No, you are in a hallway with occasionally other people.
Okay. Well. All right, little guy.
We've got to do that thing that they do in the movies where they're trying to look like they're not assaulting someone, and they put their arm around them a bit roughly and ruffle their hair too much, and like give them a friendly squeeze.
I'm gonna let Yigbeth do that.
Are you sure about this? I don't know.
He might die. Like,
Yigbeth's idea of what a hair ruffle is
whew. Oh yeah, that's a good point.
Okay, so you take him and, you know, jostle him around a wee bit, and it's all good fun. You feel a sharp sensation in your side. He
shanked you.
He has taken out a little knife from under his belt.
Okay,
and he's not sticking you with it.
Okay.
But he's letting you know it's there. And he says, please, I don't want this to go bad.
I'm just going to point the spear at him and say, well...
Yo, guys, we are on the street. Mm-hmm. Keep it cool.
I'm going to tell him that cool. I can freeze every single muscle in his body.
I can cut your femoral artery.
Well,
you might.
If I do mine first, you won't.
Oh, you won't. You what won't.
All right, cool
this
out.
This kid is
cool
getting
out,
everybody.
Is... Cool out. Let's figure out.
You see, listen to the smart guy. He knows what's what.
Oh, you shut the fuck up.
I just roll my eyes and sort of elbow cubbing go, kids, eh?
Kids today, they grow up so fast.
How dare you, try and figure out who's the smart guy.
I'm saying you're the smart guy. It's obvious.
Oh, shut the fuck
Bad word!
You owe me a penny.
Oh my god, I'm gonna stab him. I'm gonna stab him with this spear in a minute.
I really do want to go ahead and try and disarm him.
Let's do it outside.
Well, you want to take his arms off?
Yeah, I want... You get the damn, if Takuna were here! And we damn! Will pull.
I'm gonna... Dish,
we need you to separate this guy from his legs.
I'm gonna... Can I grab him?
Don't worry about me.
His arm and drag him outside.
Yeah, we're going to try and keep it moving.
You're currently holding him, so yeah, you can certainly sort of bring him outside, and he will follow along with you. He says...
Can we get to a place where there aren't a lot of people?
Yes. In fact, you're walking off to a slightly, not deserted, but not well-trafficked area of the city. It's really only a couple of streets over.
Okay, can I see if he's still holding the knife?
Yes, the more pressure you put on him, the more he sort of makes sure that you know that that knife is somewhere dangerous.
Okay, well, I'm going to do this. And I'm going to say...
No, how do you cast that?
Just say it. Say a single word.
Component V.
Yeah. So I say grovel.
Would you not do drop?
Drop it. Just drops whatever. Well, I mean, he can just run away.
Okay. So I am going to roll my wisdom save, and that is a 19.
Oh fuck off!
Ooh.
And he says, "No, I don't think so. Look." I'm not your enemy here.
Does anyone else? I don't want to spend all my spell slots on this guy again.
Wrong character.
He says, no, seriously, please don't try and do that again. It's pointless. I'm not going to do anything bad against you. You are like six adults, five adults, and you're clearly not happy with me. I get it. I understand. But... I have to protect myself. Is that not fair?
Nope.
Oh my god, just take us to the house.
I want to go for a sleight of hand and take this knife off him.
Okay.
Can I
go
you go first.
How much could you get for that knife, do you reckon?
What? Okay. I bet he just bought the knife for 40,000 gold.
Okay. Oh, man. That is actually very good. So you manage to grab his hand and essentially yank the hand away without Yigbeth getting cut. And he says, oh, well, yeah, okay, you win.
Well, yeah.
What did you spend the money on?
Just talk to us, guy.
You've got me you've taken me hostage here, and this is just...
Start talking.
You also stole a ton of money. This is the same thing.
That is true, but did I endanger your lives?
Can I do a sleight of hand check just to right kick me with the eternal chalk on the back of a shirt? the K-I-K-M-E.
He feels that and he looks around and he says,
and then I drop into a crouch.
Where'd you go? It's uncanny.
Yeah.
So, okay, he says, okay, I'll tell you, just ease off, okay?
Maybe.
Look, you don't know how hard it is out here.
That's true.
Maybe.
He actually seems to sort of change away from this sort of bluster and confidence that he had, and he becomes a little bit more natural, shall we say. And he says, look, I don't know where you guys are from. I don't know where you live. I'm sure you don't live in the poor city, by the way you're dressed. But me...
I fluff my collar.
I stroke my plus one religious robes.
Me and everyone in our home, we rely on that place. And... with the gangs and everything, claim and protection money, there's no way for us to... That place is going to close.
So that's where the money went.
It's not there entirely, but that's what I do. I go out into the city and I get stuff. And I bring it back, and I make sure there's always enough to pay for to pay our protection.
I'm gonna ask him where else it went.
Okay, so sometimes I need stuff to get other stuff. So you know, you gotta speculate to accumulate.
I need a little bit more than that, my guy.
What stuff did you accumulate?
Sometimes,
speculate on whichever way around.
Sometimes I buy magical items, weapons, things to...
Oh, that's why he used that crazy smoke or whatever.
That knife, for example, is pretty good. It can, it's very good against armor, you know. It's got a great armor-piercing value, shall we say. And on inspection, that does seem like a very nice knife. And he says, so, yeah, here we are.
All right, guy. Now, of the accumulation you've done,
mm-hmm.
How much of it was the spot we found you.
That was good. That was a good day when I found that. I'll not lie. That was the biggest I've ever found. And that's secured our future for years.
Mm-hmm. So what else did you do? Did you mug people?
No, I've never hurt anyone. I mean, look at me. I'm tiny.
Magical knife, which he almost shanked me with.
Yeah, and I feel really bad about that.
Doesn't he look at all sincere?
You've done more damage to my scalp than I did to you with that knife.
Yeah, I'm gonna need to know if he's fibbing on that one.
Fibbing on which one's right?
Whether he's like actually, is he actually sorrowful about having to resort to almost violence?
Oh, right. Yeah, give me a roll.
Okay.
I'm going to do it as well.
Okay.
Okay, so you definitely get the idea that he's not at all sorrowful. But what he is was scared and a little bit over his head, in over his head. And he was trying to do the best he could.
Now, how old is this kid?
He is around 7, 8.
I'm keeping that knife.
No.
That don't belong to you, little guy. Nuh-uh. You can have smoke bombs. You want to play that game. You want to burglarize. You want to try and act big.
No, don't.
You can play smoke bombs.
Don't steal from people. You said you had enough for years. Now invest that or something. Just don't
steal. Hey, I have not been out anywhere since I found that stash. I haven't had to.
Good.
Well, I mean, I was out today, but, you know, that was just to make sure.
Oh, he's so full of it.
Look, I was out, see, today I was out doing my thing when the tunnel collapsed. See, I thought I'd be trapped down there. I was coming back, and I actually have been using this house as a sort of a quick and easy entry point into the Undercity. So, yeah, I was coming back, and suddenly there was this shaking underground, and yeah, the tunnel collapsed, and I thought, oh no, I'm going to be trapped down here. And then I remembered, oh yeah, I can go anywhere else. So I took the long way around, and then I wanted to tell Crimples what had happened. So I had to sort of go back to the entrance and redig it, go into the place, and yeah, here we are.
All right, show us that route.
Okay, so the building itself is in this semi-abandoned area, and he leads you around the side of it, and basically shows you a little, he moves a box or two and shows you this little tunnel that he has been entering into. Plenty big enough for any of you to get through.
All right.
So, Finch says to says to Yugbeth, he asks, what is it that you feel when you pray to Tyr? I'm always kind of worried that he hasn't blessed me, or he doesn't see me as being worthy, and I'm just sort of curious.
Anger.
Ask me another time.
Wrathful righteousness.
Okay. I can see it's obviously a very complicated emotion to put in. Yeah, that makes sense. And yeah. So, I take it you all crawl through the tunnel?
Yep.
I'm down.
I do my little eternal chalk mark arrows just in case, once again.
Yeah, that you're worried that...
Yeah, I'm always very worried. I got lost very easily. I love this chalk.
Right, okay. And he says, that comes off, doesn't it?
Sure. It comes off when I roll it.
So, you find yourself inside this building, and indeed, you see just this huge... For a start, the roof is sagging in, because it's almost completely unsupported now. That looks kind of dangerous. And there is just this, all the floors have been like just collapsed into this, what looks like a giant sinkhole.
Mm.
And let's see. Marcus says to you, do you need me for anything more or can I go back?
I throw him into the hole. No.
I'm going to say, well, you're going to be around there, yes?
Yeah, you kind of have me at a disadvantage here.
All right, I know where you live.
Okay.
And I think it's time for us to let him go. I know he's going to be a rapscallion.
Burn down your place.
What?
Oh.
What kind of paladin are you? Finch is looking kind of intently at that seems like a reasonable question to him at this very moment.
The righteous kind.
And he sort of rolls his eyes and he scarpers off. So, you are now inside this building. And yeah, at the moment, all you see is just this big pit.
Okay, well,
If you want to throw yourselves onto the map,
let's do it.
Going up from the top?
This sort of little area here is the tunnel that you crawled through to get in the house. So you can basically position yourself anywhere you want. And, what do you want to do?
I have got, as part of my thieves' tools kit, a set of pitons, which are like little chisels you kind of smash into the rock, and we can tie ropes to those and try and climb down.
That is very good. The pit is steep, but it's not. You could climb down it. Well, I won't say no problem, but yeah, you could. The pitons are definitely going to make it easy, and you don't have to roll anything.
How far down is it?
Vaguely, it's slightly further down than the building is tall. And you can see the bottom.
Okay.
It looks like it's just collapsed in. It doesn't look like it doesn't look like there's an entryway to anything down there.
Mm-hmm.
So this was created during the explosions?
He told you that he had he wasn't able to get into the house, and that was before the explosions.
You know what? I'm gonna spend 10 minutes detecting some magic while y'all do whatever. Yeah. The only divination spell I actually prepped.
Nice.
Can I? I'm gonna do a thing as divine sense.
Okay, so you're doing your CSI magic and holy.
Yes.
It's the hot new cop show. Magic and holy man. let's see. Anyone else want to do anything while they're doing that? I will give you your results at the end of the other players' actions.
Okay. If I misunderstood the like exact depth of this thing and kind of the circumstances, then let's not worry about the pitons. I'm going to try and investigate the area, sort of just get an idea of what's going on.
Search for any call marks.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm going to just sort of like roam around and take a look, try and figure out exactly precisely how this went down. Do my own little forensics investigation.
Okay, so do you want to move yourselves to, let's say that the pitons make it very easy to get around for everyone. You can now position yourself on the map somewhere that you want to look, and if you're near something, I have little secret markers all around.
Ooh.
If you're near something and you get the appropriate number, you're going to find something.
How exciting.
Mm-hmm. So, everyone give me a perception check.
Because we're great at that.
These.
Yep.
All right, yeah, I'm good at these.
Established.
Woo!
Oh my god.
Okay. Well, you're looking at other stuff. So, Kirby, let's see, are you staying there?
No, I'm gonna move around a little bit.
Oh, you know what? It's okay. Right, so Veer Seraph, Finna and Blaze, good grief, me and names. Finn and Keys both find something.
Ooh, wizard senses tingling.
Yes. Finna, you find, after having a little dig around a slightly odd bump in the ground, a hand.
Oh!
That leads to an arm.
Ah!
That leads to a shoulder and a head and a person.
Everyone, I found a hand that leads to an arm that leads to a shoulder.
I'm sure there's a more succinct way to say that, but I don't know what to say.
No, that's all I yelled at. Canon now.
Yeah. You find a dead body.
Oh.
I found someone who's dead.
Mm-hmm.
Is that did I detect that with my magic, or did I just kind of?
No, the magic is going to be something else, and you are your magic sense is tingling.
So,
Blaze, you also find a body. It's slightly to your south, but yeah.
You find a foot attached to a leg attached to a thigh.
You find a toenail that's attached to a toe. That's etc. So
that goes on a long way. Okay, I'm gonna try and figure out exactly how they died. I assume like there was just kind of some crash. Like was there a There was a collapse into this floor, right, during the explosion.
Yeah.
But did that collapse the bottom floor of the home for the Ute?
It's very easy to tell that these bodies, there's something, they've been crushed, essentially. That's your first, that's the obvious thing.
Right.
But if you want to do any more, you're going to need some sort of investigation or... whatever rule, medical maybe.
Oh, it's going down.
What you got? Investigation. Okay, 14. Yeah, that's just about enough. I'll not make you roll again. You can see that the damage is like they've been crushed to death, it doesn't look like damage that's... It essentially looks like a creature has done this. Like there's handprints, large handprints. let's see, do you want to move again and do another search? Might do this one or two more times.
I'm going to keep searching. Does my holy thing not do anything?
Well, we're going to do this sort of a little later. The results are going to come up, but you can certainly search again.
Can I search? Yeah, search this place again.
Yep. Okay, so Yigbeth, she rolls good. Scoo, yep, that's very good. And Finna and Keys, you can roll again as well. So Yigbeth, you come up with another body. Another single body.
Guys, I found a hair connected to head.
No, get it right, connected to a follicle. Stason. You find a little, like a drawstring, which... you dig out.
Is it attached to a waist?
It is attached to a small knapsack.
Ooh.
Lift out of the ground, and inside there's just general odds and sods that you would find in perhaps a homeless person's bindle. But there is also a note that is scratched and torn, but part of it is still readable. Mm. And...
what does it say?
It says this, and anyone who wants to read it, in fact, Scoo, you're going to read it.
In a voice?
Yep.
No, I'm not doing it in a voice.
Well,
I read it in Stason's
voice. No. Exactly.
Your own bloody fool, if you haven't got the money, leave the city. Selwyn's dead, and every man for himself. Just lie low for a bit, and things will blow over.
Mm-hmm. Impeccable, I would say.
That wasn't my Stason, obviously, but
yeah, it was his brother,
Jason. Yeah.
So, you find that inside. No. Let's see. Who else was going to... Oh, wow. Keys. That is a good one.
Finally. And,
Finna, did you roll again?
Oh, I didn't. Sorry, I'm going to do that.
That's okay.
Can I check my... Can I check this body to see if there's anything particularly interesting about it?
You can, yeah. Sorry, Cubby, you... Oh, you did roll. Did you? Didn't you?
I'll roll again just to be sure. What's the harm?
Okay, nice. Right.
Oh.
Well, you do find something because you're standing right on it. You feel a sort of breeze, a slight breeze against your skin.
Oh.
And looking around, you essentially find it's coming from a little sort of place right next to you, and you pull away some rock and it falls away, leading to a large tunnel.
Ooh.
Yes.
A large tunnel.
A large tunnel. Keys, because that roll was so good, you find that down in the center, there are pillars that have been knocked over. And they look like they were some sort of foundation for the house.
So we're looking at an animal that has crushed people and knocked pillars over.
Yigbeth, with her medicine roll, which is rather good, you find that indeed there... you find corroborating evidence for that. You find, see very big handprints, and these people have been just crushed to death with...
Does this look anything like Birdman-y?
No, with Birdman, I say in massive inverted commas because he's not a Birdman. he did a very sort of sharp claws and scratching and so forth. This is just like big, powerful, holy crap, don't want to mess with stuff. So yeah. And let's see. You find a further two bodies, so you find a total of five bodies in here. let's see. So you find this opening, this tunnel, and you find all that other stuff. Now, as you've been searching,
what's the race of these bodies?
They're mostly human. There is a half elf there as well.
Do we remember the races of the party? The other party.
Oh right. No, they've sort of been accounted for. I can't remember them off the top of my head, but
they've all been found.
Yeah.
Dead.
But you've Crimplesham did tell you that there were seven people living in here and you found five.
So the two weird ones, two dodgy weird ones are gone, probably.
No, the results of your holy and magical searches are coming in. And you get a sense.
Text on my phone.
Finna.
A printout just kind of materializes in thin air.
It says,
results from the lab say.
Complete with old school new printer phone sounds.
Just like out of thin air.
The original series of Batman where he'd get the punch card out of the computer.
So, Finna, you get the sense that something magical has occurred here, and not in that sense. It's...
Or maybe it has before, I don't know.
Something happened with... either someone cast a spell here sort of early in the morning, late last night, or something with that was imbued with magic came here. Yigbeth, you sensed something very similar. Either someone was praying to an evil god, or something connected to an evil god came here.
So I tell everyone this.
I tell everyone this.
Right.
I tell everyone about this cool tunnel I found. Secret tunnel!
Could I have one more perception roll from one person? You nominate.
Keys redeemed yourself.
Okay.
That's it. That's it. You're banned. You're banned from doing random perception rolls.
Just one person, huh?
Cubby's
the new.
I'll give you one.
Cubby's the new perceptor.
Thinking about it, it has to be Stason.
Are you giving me another shot?
I'm giving Stason another shot. It can only be him.
It can only be me.
Well, I suppose it could be Ignis as well. But
damn it.
Got it.
All right, then.
Whoever.
Yigbeth.
Excellent.
Yeah.
All right, Yigbeth. Hey.
Yay for me. Fuck off.
No, it's definitely me. I remember now.
Okay, so.
Just saying.
God damn it. Carry on.
That's it. All right, he has to do it.
I'll tell you what, I'll be nice, because that was a very good roll, A, and B, it kind of makes sense that you would smell this.
Because he dealt it.
He did indeed.
I'm the villain.
What you smell is the smell of a humanoid creature that typically has two heads and is very large.
Oh no.
I somehow know the smell of Etten.
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh no.
I think I'm required to turn around and say, "Thar be giants."
I just kind of
giants
shrug.
In these bowls.
I just kind of shrug and check them out. I don't know what's going on.
With two heads. The smell is unmistakable.
Can distinctly smell.
Yes.
At the sound of Cubby saying this, Yigbeth goes into shock.
Keys is like, fuck.
Finch puts his hand on your shoulder, says, "Don't worry, we have Tyr on our side. We'll be fine."
I look at him with my shocked expression.
I look over at the young Zell and say, isn't Tyr missing a hand?
An eye.
An eye,
Isn't that... what's his face?
Oh, oh crap, no, you're right. Oh no, please don't tell anyone, I forgot that.
You mixed up the God of Justice with the patron deity of orcs? Don't worry about it, kid.
Oh no. So there is that tunnel.
Guys, we are in some trouble.
Yeah.
And it's a story that, well,
I'm gonna tell the story very, very much not mentioning that I teached an Eden how to be a paladin of Orcus. Because, in retrospect, that really doesn't... I don't know how that happened. I don't remember agreeing to that ever.
Magic.
Now I've become evil.
Jazz hands.
Yep. Guys, we're in a lot of trouble is actually the subtitle of this entire campaign. Mm-hmm. But...
Mm-hmm.
What would you like to do now?
I'm just going to let everybody know roughly what happened, especially emphasizing how it was not our fault that an Etten became a paladin of Orcus and led the entire Etten workforce of this city out in a holy crusade and just like destroyed the pens and the stables that they were confined to. So there's a small army of Ettens led by one insanely bardically inspired super paladine Etten.
Oh.
So I think...
Why did we
like
ever we do that?
It was a really good idea.
sounds like we should check out this tunnel and then wipe out that army of Ettins that is in no way your fault.
Mm-hmm. I think you might be right. I think you just might be right. Easy. It sounds a little bit easier than I bet it will be, but it's a hard knock life.
Do you remember how long it took us to subdue one Ettin when we had sleeping poison?
Yeah, it took us like 8 rounds or something. It's on.
Yeah.
We got it.
So, you make... Oh, one thing before we go as well. There is something in that note that just tickles your brain, perhaps, maybe, memory, something.
The name? Is it the name?
Could be the name.
Where is it?
Because when you sort of light upon the idea of Ettins, that name starts to flash.
Was he one of the striking Ettin ranchers?
Aha.
Huh?
Wow.
What?
Okay. When we were trying to subdue our Ettin, there were a bunch of Ettin hunters, and we basically functioned as scabs. They went on strike, and
did we kill any of them?
We killed a lot of them.
Yeah, a couple got away.
That's their fault for coming at us. But
I did mention in the first sort of session back in this series that there is a general question of where they went. The city had been wondering, because these guys are known as Ettin hunters, and because this disaster was Ettin related, there's been a lot of interest in finding them. We never really followed up on it, but that was raised, I think, anyway. So, yeah.
Dang.
So, with that, you follow the tunnel. It doesn't go very far until it comes out in a very regular, very well-constructed and extremely long shaft. There is a little bit of natural daylight coming in from the top, and it seems like this is the trench that goes up the side of the mountain underneath the funicular.
Oh, they just like literally plowed through the earth?
No, this trench has been here since the funicular was built. It is that they used to walk this in order to power.
And now they use it against us.
So, yeah. And just as you come out into it, you, Yigbeth, suffer an incredibly bad headache.
Just is this like Orcus again?
Your brain is on fire. You can't really hide this. You've nearly fallen over.
Oh.
And at this point, I would like to ask you all, do you want to run this as in me and Teddy go into a separate thing to work out what he says and how this goes? Or do you just want to listen and not use the information in an unfair way?
I absolutely want to listen to the word of Orcus.
Yeah, that's no problem.
Is this them? Their characters can hear this.
No,
the difference is like we as players have to act as if we do not hear this.
Yeah.
Which, like, I'm in for the juicy deets. Gossip is why I play D&D.
But it is obvious that something has happened to Yigbeth. She can't really hide that much. Or, you know, there's something's going on. Okay. And you hear a voice. And it says, little conduit, the time has come for you to serve. I know not where they hide. It is your task to find them. But they are close. This I sense. Excuse yourself and hunt them down like the dogs they are.
You want me
this
to,
I command.
You want me to hunt down your servant?
He is clearly talking about Sarah and Cersei Fames.
Oh. Oh, right.
He wants you to, as we did before, he wants you to kill them for their crimes and bring justice to them. The pressure in your head just leaves as suddenly as it arrived, and you find everyone sort of looking at you, and Finch is especially wide-eyed, and he says, was that Tyr? Did Tyr just speak to you then? That looked just like what happened to the Prophet Azoz in the Prefectoria.
No, it was just the sudden change in elevation as we dropped down. It really caused me a big headache.
And he looks very disappointed. Oh, of course, okay. I understand. You can tell he's kind of crushed. He really got his hopes up there. So, what do you do? Final question off this. What do you do?
Go in hunting.
Well, this is a question especially for Yigbeth, but yeah, for you guys as well.
Oh, you said that the city is wondering what happened to those Etten hunters, right? Yeah. I don't suppose we could all form alternate identities and just pose as them from now onward.
Why would we want to do that?
Well, because then they wouldn't want Brian an investigation Egg into Hunter. Their deaths.
What?
Then, you know, the city wouldn't launch an investigation into their deaths and try to, you know, establish wrongdoing.
Yeah, but then they'll, like, ask us what they will probably be the first suspects at the Etten Revolution.
Right, but if we're disguised as the Etten Hunters and to take on their identities, I'm suggesting identity theft.
I was going to suggest, you remember how we wanted to secondarily cause a war?
Yeah.
Well, Ettens?
Can we use the Ettens? Maybe I can talk to the Etten leader and be like, hey Orcus pal, how about you destroy the Durrans?
Yeah, Orcus hates the Durrans, obviously. Everyone hates the Durrans.
That is true.
So,
and then the Arkhan, if you live.
Yeah.
So, right. So, I guess what I want to know is, what are you guys going to want to go and hunt the Ettens? Are you going to want to go and talk to the Ettens? Are you going to want to, what do you want? What does the party want to do? And then I want to know specifically what Yigbeth wants to do, because you have just been given your marching orders.
I'm pretty down to go Etten hunting.
I think we'll see how they react to us first. Before.
Yeah, let's seek out the Ettens. Maybe not Etten hunting versus Etten talking, but let's seek them out.
Okay.
Yeah.
Cool. That is settled. Now, Teddy, what is Yigbeth thinking right now, and what does she do in response to what she's just been told to do? Big decision time.
What do you mean? You want me to decide if I just go off and kill the Fames right now?
I want you to tell me what you intend to do. What you literally do in the next 20 seconds.
Nothing. I go Etten hunting.
But you have been, not just...
What, right now?
Right now.
Well, I can't.
You can.
Well,
you can do anything you want.
It would be incredibly suspicious.
Yep. I mean, it's and up also, to you to make it. It's up to you to make it not suspicious.
No, I think I'll go with the Ettens.
You're going with the Ettens, okay? Right. And as the pressure increases inside your head...
Oh, am I just going to explode?
We'll find out next week.
Oh.
Okay. Session is done.
Good, good.
Cool. Thank you all for playing. Please come again. Maybe I'll even get back onto some sort of schedule. Miracles can happen.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Just very quiet and subdued party after.
Yeah. Sorry.
You did great. I'm just thinking of all the things I can use my new wand on.
Yes. Oh, yeah, you get a wand of whatever.
Well, if I ever...
Yes.
If I ever want to, like, up my strength or, like, constitution, I now have a really good in-game reason for it going up. Just all these squads, man.
Mm. Oh, exactly, yeah.
All of these stealth That's squads.
Have you just been you squatting travel? The entire time?
And just quietly cackling to myself every time I'm quiet. I'm actually just kind of in a crouch.
Just pop in a squat?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, dear.
I'm
going to be the wizard with the best legs in the world.
Oh, yes.
Long-distance wizard.
I feel like that's got to be some kind of contest that needs to be played out.
I'll work it into my backstory, don't you worry.
Next season. Kobold.
The wizard leg beauty pageant?
Well, it's not so much beauty as endurance. It's some sort of like weightlifting competition.
Mm-hmm. For wizards only?
Mm-hmm.
Oh.
No invisible servants allowed.
Ooh. No.
Don't the invisible
training.
Servants have like a weight strength of 2 or something?
Yeah. It's not a lot.
True.
Wow, everyone really is so quiet. Where'd everyone go? You guys alive? You doing
I feel
okay?
Like I've insulted some.
I'm only half joking when I said I would be into creating kobold. Rebuild our lair and hideout session.
We've assumed new identities.
Yeah.
So we clearly need new digs to suit our new identities.
Are we taking on the identity of the Enten Hunters? Because that would be pretty sweet.
Are you saying you want to pretend to be these Enten Hunters?
The dead ones, yes. Yes. Yeah.
I'm kind of fuzzy on the logic of what that achieves.
What made you think there was logic?
No, but...
Your first mistake.
Is that, like, something that you're trying to get something out of?
It just seems like fun.
Oh, right, okay.
Also because, as I was saying, you know, you were saying that the city is somewhat worried about what's happened to these people, and our current identities appear to be causing us no end of trouble in terms of people coming to, you know, find us and do us harm. Whereas very conveniently, there's this whole group of adventurers who is dead, that the city doesn't really know what happened to them, whose identities we could take on if we are good enough at disguising ourselves. And they won't be able, the city will then be like, oh, so they're totally fine. And these other people have just skipped town because everyone dislikes them for some, let's say, unstated reason.
Well,
it'd be a very convenient alternate identity.
Yeah.
The problem with any sort of like long-term identity theft is that Keyes is really vain about who he is.
I see. So you're telling me that the problem is Keyes.
Well, no, because a lot of people are going to recognize Stace and Jason as well if he rocks up looking different. Or not looking different, but you know what I mean. With a different name.
There's no hiding that face.
Mm-hmm. That face in Jason.
He can pull off wigs. That's one thing he can do, because there's no hair sort of to ruin that.
I feel like people would also recognize him just by the pecs as well. Don't know.
Mm-hmm. That's also true of Hawkins. Hey, by the pecs.
Oh.
All right, I gotta head out. Bye. Okay.
All right, take care.
Bye.
Right.
I really admire the complexity of the situation in which we're in. Like I really like the three front thing we got going on. It is just
I was very sort of keen to bring the Ettins back into it, but I didn't want to just overload it from the start.
Oh man, that makes it just juicy and complex. This is not an easy thing we got.
No.
Especially, I think, because like of the party, Keyes has like wholeheartedly embraced the Arcan, because politics is the art of compromise. And I don't think the rest of the party is down with that, like at all.
With vampires?
Yeah.
How do you feel about vampires?
Yeah, where's Cubby on this?
Well, I am a druid, so you might think that I would just be against the undead by default, but I've always thought that that's kind of a lazy way to role play a druid. Before I can answer that question, I have to decide what druids think is natural and unnatural in a world of magic.
Yeah, that is a very good question.
Are the undead a natural part, a normal part of life in this world?
I guess the idea, I suppose, is necromancy is sort of breaking one of the rules of nature, wouldn't you say? Or is that reasonable?
I mean, what are the rules of nature in a world with magic?
Well, I mean, truly, okay, in that case, everything would be natural.
I mean, you may as well. Here's the thing, though. Like, human beings are kind of the main dudes that are operating with magic. And so you would have to say, what is it's basically the equivalent of saying, what is nature in a world with technology, right? Like, if magic is changing the fundamental reality of something by means of will, then how is magic any different from technology when you're determining what's natural?
Point.
Right, and as a druid, I use magic, and essentially, you know, humans are what, like, very highly advanced bipedal ants as far as their effects on nature.
Yeah, and in the game.
my question would be: is there like
do you look at the sort of effect? I guess, you know, is it not so much a judgment on death itself, but on like the result of that? Like, if you create an army of zombies to help you build a house, could be a good action. But if you create an army of zombies to take over the world, less good, or, you know, vice versa.
Well, you're throwing morality into the mix, which think is really the purview of nature.
Is very much neutral. You're very neutral.
Well, you know, the law of nature is very much just one about pure survival. My real question is there some fundamental law of the universe that has to be broken that will result in just wanton, unchecked destruction when an undead creature is made or, you know, comes into being? Or is it a process that occurs normally in some circumstances, et cetera, et cetera?
I think if you're like thinking about this as pure survival, then sort of you should do something if you, of course, you can't really ensure the survival of everything, so you have to ensure your own survival only. Like, you would only see the vampires as something bad if they were a threat to your survival.
We did have a sort of a talk with Simon Amer a couple of sessions ago, and he was sort of talking along similar lines. There was sort of a, he was trying to make the party understand his viewpoint and, you know, the fact that being a vampire might be cool and all, but there's a high degree of, you have to be really interested in your own survival. It's not a given. People, when people hear the word vampire, you know, they get the pitchforks out automatically. And that's why they've been sort of hiding here. So I don't know if that's like a... Well, the conversation ran along those lines. So I don't know if that makes you view them in any particular way. At the same time, they are killing people.
Well, like how many people? A lot of things kill people.
Exactly. They. What Simon has told the group is that they generally try not to kill anyone they don't have to. You know, they want to keep their existence a secret, and they essentially only kill when they kill people who won't be missed, as they say. And they don't kill people very often. The wild card in that situation is Alant Harlow, the sort of apparently the oldest of the vampires, who seems to be a bit more bucking against that trend.
Yeah, he, I kind of want to eat impulsive. That dude's lunch and then take his place. Is kind of Key's goal.
Become a vampire. I was about to say
it sounds like they are a fairly normal group of predators as far as the world of nature would view them. And that just one of them seems to be a big problem. Not even a big problem as far as how you're describing. It's like, this guy kills a little bit more than normal.
Well, I mean, they've sort of also seen him get angry.
Yeah, but getting mad doesn't...
Or they've seen what happens to people he's angry with.
Okay. Do they die?
They get their jaws ripped off?
I mean, yes.
They, it's very they were similar to what happens when people make Ovan angry.
So, I'm just going to throw out there. Number one, there are funguses in nature that essentially zombify things for their own survival, part of their normal life cycle. So...
You know, they also rip your jawbone if you make them angry.
Well, if you want to look at, you know, like wild acts of violence, it's not difficult to find with, you know, big powerful animals either.
True. Dolphins?
Dolphins can be pretty mean. killer whales, polar bears.
Man, speaking of dolphins, I just discovered the GameCube emulator.
I saw you playing that. I was going to say something about it.
Oh my fucking God. I've been on Thousand Year Door for a hot minute. It's a fantastic game.
Thousand Year Door. What's that one?
It is Paper Mario number 2.
Oh, I
know. So it is like a Mario RPG sort of thing, and it is just fucking adorable. It truly is. It's got Mario and it's turn-based tactics, but then there's action sections so that you press like a given button at a right time, or you perform like an on-screen quick time event at the right time, and your attack is more effective, or your dodge is more effective, or whatever.
Okay. So it is sort of JRPG.
You engaged. Yeah, it's like a JRPG, but in a way that keeps you so much more engaged at every single second during the combat.
Okay.
And that part is interesting. It's got a lot of good puzzles and like some platforming, which is actually very bad because this is like supposed to be 2D, but it's in 3D, and that part kind of makes things hard. You're paper thin. It's all presented in like a paper Milo.
Yeah.
And that kind of makes platforming hard, but overall it's really just been a delightful little game.
Cool.
I'm probably going to kill it by the end of this weekend if I can put enough hours.
Nice one. I like the sound of it. So, anything else needs clearing up?
How much experience?
Level 20!
Yeah, we did it.
You win. You win everything. Let's see. I'm going to give you... I was going to give you the max of 2,000, but I'm going to give you 2,100 because someone did something really smart during the game, and I don't even remember what it is now, but I just remember saying, right, you have to have a bonus for that. So well done, whoever it was.
I'm sure it was me. It was clearly
it
me.
It probably was. And in
16400.
Also, you get the credit for
165, isn't it?
Putting in that Jumbotron message, because that was just like...
Was it? Oh, yeah.
That is just the nicest thing ever.
Dude, I am so glad. I am so glad that you got called out to a show about good role-playing for awesome role-playing games.
So, we are now a world-famous podcast.
Yeah, definitely.
Sort of.
All right, 16500, according to Blood Ted. And,
no, it's, yeah, it's 16400.
Oh, you motherfucker. You gaslit me. All right, I'm going to get the hell out. I have had such a good time. Everybody, stay fly.
You too.
Name of your sex tape.
Peace out.
Later.
Bye.
Bye.